This album sucks. In a world of indie rock and punk, the last thing you want to do is sell out. I personally rarely see a big deal with it. Changing the songs you make to be more commercially friendly can work well if you're a good songwriter and don't lose any of the quality that you had before. Music at the end of the day is a business, and if you want to make a living making music, you're gonna have to take smart business choices and make music that has a wider appeal. An example of a band accused of selling out are Metallica. The 90s was a decade where they made music that drifted away from the abrasive, chaotic, thrash sound of their earlier work and drifted into a more classic heavy metal sound, which ended up widening their appeal and allowing their music to be played on rock radio. They may only have one good album in the 90s, but that self-titled album was proof that it's possible to widen your appeal without losing the quality of songwriting that attracted people to you to begin with. Liz Phair really should have taken a page from that book. Liz Phair is undoubtedly one of the most influential singer-songwriters of the past 30 years. Her 1993 debut Exile in Guyville is a landmark album in indie rock and feminism in the music scene, paving the way for musicians like Cat Power, Alanis Morissette, as well as more modern indie rock singers such as Snail Mail and Courtney Barnett. Guyville is an absolute masterpiece with its abrasive and lo-fi tone, honest and direct lyrics, and Phair's vocals which range from being pitch perfect to rough and gritty. It's an absolute unparalleled masterpiece. She followed it up with Whip Smart, an album which is basically a more polished Guyville with a handful of really great material alongside quite a few really forgettable tracks. The album even led to the first of her two Grammy nominations with the lead single Supernova. Her third album, White Chocolate Space Egg, is a bit of a weird one because there's songs on it that I think are some of the best that she's ever done and also some of the worst she's ever done. It's way cleaner than her previous two albums, and it's basically the heavily produced indie rock sound that all of her contemporaries at that point were following. But it's also an incredibly mature yet intimate album, discussing her life as a wife, a mother, and a 30-year-old woman. But it still has all that dry humor that made the lyrical content of Guyville so engaging to begin with. I would still pick Guyville 10 out of 10 times over these two albums, though. Following the release of her third album, Phair didn't really do much music for a while. She supported Alanis Morissette on tour, made guest appearances on songs by singers like Sheryl Crow, and even acted in a film called Cherish, which I honestly have never heard of. White Chocolate Space Egg was released via Matador and Capitol. However, shortly after, she left Matador to work solely with Capitol Records. She started working on a new album with songwriter Michael Penn. However, Capitol reacted poorly and refused to release the songs in their current states. Having spent the entire budget for the album, the president of Capitol told Phair that they would only give her more money to finish the album if she worked with production team The Matrix on four new songs. Who are these guys, you may ask? Yeah, The Matrix were heavily involved in writing and producing Avril Lavigne's debut album. When it came to 2000s teen pop, The Matrix pretty much dominated the entire scene and worked with every artist, including Hilary Duff, Ashley Tisdale, Miranda Cosgrove, Busted, Britney Spears, McFly, Tokyo Hotel, and even Korn, the last of which made some of the best teen pop ever.
Y'all can suck my dick and fuck it like it!
But hey, Liz Phair is a fantastic songwriter. I'm sure she had a clear vision of this album that wasn't bogged at all by being on a major label and using pop songwriters. Maybe Capitol just didn't like the direction of the album that she was taking because it was too out there or something. At least I sure hope so. Liz Phair's self-titled album is complete garbage. When this album isn't a cliché, derivative, and overly glossy slice of sugary pop, it is an embarrassingly cringy and almost hilariously terrible pop rock album. The biggest problem I have with this album is that it just basically spits in the face of everything that Phair stood for on Guyville, as well as completely scrapping any sense of maturity and evolution that appeared on her previous record to create this incredibly juvenile and awkward record full of some of the worst pop rock music to ever grace the earth. The album opens with the song Extraordinary, which all things considered is actually a pretty fun and catchy pop punk song. This is possibly the only song on the album that when I try and open my mind to the new sound and forget about the fact that it was written by the woman who wrote great songs like Fuck and Run Over a decade before that, I can actually enjoy it. Extraordinary is basically that Matrix sound, the very huge distorted guitars, heavy vocal production, clean and glitzy choruses, and very teenage girl-esque lyrics. It's a very cheesy song, and lyrically it's actually pretty terrible as well. It's all about Liz getting her crush to notice her and her singing about the length she'll go to get him. It's the exact same formula that Matrix followed with pretty much every single Avril Lavigne song. And to be fair, I think if the song was sung by someone else, like Avril Lavigne for example, it probably would not only have been more successful, but probably also would have worked a lot better. But for what it is, I guess it's decent and harmless. It's followed by Red Light Fever, which is basically the exact same song, but nowhere near as catchy. The thing about this song is that it's not offensively bad like some of the other songs on the album, it's just really bland. The song is just pure filler to the point where it sounds like Phair wrote it in 10 minutes and just kinda stuck it on the album. The song is about a guy who struggles with commitment and can't make his mind up when it comes to his life, yet constantly tells other people what to do. I guess I can't say the idea of the song is too bad or anything, but lyrically it's so uninteresting and incredibly predictable to the point where you can almost guess exactly what she's going to sing next. Until we get to the chorus and she just kinda forgets that rhyming in lyrics is a thing. The last line of both bars sounds so tacked on that it's almost like she realized that she didn't have enough lines for the whole chorus and just wrote the first thing she thought of, regardless of whether they fit in. The bridge is incredibly repetitive as well. It basically copies the chorus melody, which is already repetitive enough, and then basically sings the same couple lines repeatedly. But I guess it's a kind of a blessing that this song is far from offensively bad and just ends up being forgettable instead. The next song, Why Can't I, was the first single released for the album and is actually her most famous song, selling 500,000 copies and going on to be in multiple teen comedies and even Karaoke Revolution 3. The thing about this song is it's, again, basically the exact same as Extraordinary. It's an incredibly glossy, glittery pop song. Except this song is basically almost the exact same as Complicated by Avril Lavigne, just nowhere near as good. This song literally has the exact same progression of that song, including the acoustic guitars in the verses, the distorted guitars in the chorus, and the almost desperate sounding lyrics. And unlike Extraordinary, I can't look past the issues with this song and just enjoy it for what it is. Like, don't get me wrong, it's a catchy song that I've actually listened to quite a few times and never really hated completely, but it's also really terribly written. The instrumentation is incredibly bland and boring, but the lyrics in this song are at times laughably bad. The song is all about having a crush on a guy despite being in a relationship, and halfway through the song she leaves the relationship and starts dating this new guy and feels butterflies in her stomach. It's about as generic as it could be. And once again, she forgets how to rhyme all over the place in the song, which leads to lines just feeling really forced. The song starts off with her rhyming you with you, and then there's a third line in each half of the verse which just doesn't rhyme with anything at all and ends up sounding really muddled. Throughout the chorus, she repeats her rhyming you with you over again, to the point where the song ends up sounding like a first draft that was rushed without any thought. There are also multiple double entendres which are so cringy that you can't take them seriously. My favourite one being, we're already wet and we're gonna go swimming, which is possibly my favourite line on any song. The line we haven't fucked yet but my head's spinning is another really, really terrible highlight. The song definitely has a very youthful sound to it, like all of the Matrix's songs, and with singers like Hilary Duff or Avril Lavigne it works because they were teenagers when they sung and recorded the songs. However, Phair is very obviously not a teenager. She's a 36-year-old woman who sounds like a 36-year-old woman, and it ends up making the song a really uncomfortable listen. And what makes it worse is this song is far from the worst offender of this on this album. So now the big singles are out the way, how does she handle the rest of the album? What am I listening to? It's Sweet is a really terrible Bollywood inspired song, and it's a shame because lyrically it's classic Liz Phair. It has a very cryptic pseudo comedic tone to it, which with different instrumentation and maybe some better melodies could have worked a lot better, but that Bollywood sound is just so stupid and cringy. But that song is nothing on Rock Me. Another song written by The Matrix, Rock Me is one of the worst songs in the album and possibly one of the stupidest, funniest and most out of touch songs I've ever heard. So the instrumentation is literally the exact same as the singles. I can't say anything new about these songs that I didn't say about Extraordinary or Why Can't I. But lyrically, this is one of the most fascinatingly awful songs. The song is all about Phair coming onto a guy 9 years younger than her. She sings about how it's okay that he's young and how she wants to play Xbox on his floor. Honestly, that line made me laugh so much the first time I heard it. She also says about how his record collection doesn't exist and he doesn't know who Liz Phair is, which is also a pretty god-awful line. The chorus is really cringy and well, and how it substitutes Fuck Me for Rock Me, like it's some terrible piss song or something. And when you hear that lyric 5,000 times with really terrible vocal modulation and glitchy effects on it, you'll wish you've never been born. The problem with this song is it ends up sounding like it's being sung by Stifler's mum from American Pie or something, just a MILF who wants to bang all the young guys. And I know a lot of critics were blasted for being misogynistic for saying that about the album when it came out, but maybe that's just because it's very true. There's nothing wrong about being open about sex and relationships like Phair is. In fact, it was one of the best traits of her first three albums. The problem is that she does it in a way that sounds completely out of touch and juvenile, almost like she's trying to gloss herself up to fit in with the cool new young kids. And Rock Me is a prime example of her trying to do this to catastrophic results. The next song, Take a Look, is another Red Light Fever. It's not a terrible song, it's just boring and forgettable. The song is about as generic as female pop rock gets, sounding less like Avril Lavigne and more like Sheryl Crow. It has a very country pop twang to it, which makes it sound super out of place on the album. Not to mention the fact it's not got anything noteworthy in it at all. No cool instrumentation, no catchy melodies, and lyrics that are about as generic as humanly possible. On the song Little Dagger, Phair sings about being a single mother and dating while her child grows up with an absent father and has to see her dating different men. And I think it's a song with good intention that just slightly falls apart due to its unoriginal melodies and instrumentation, but it's a really cute song with nice lyrics and a good message. I just think it needed a little bit more work for it to be anything decent. The following song, Firewalk, is a very subtle, almost psychedelic ballad which sounds exactly how a commercially friendly Liz Phair album should sound. It has some pretty interesting lyrics, a nice melody, and some really great instrumentation. It's a genuinely really damn good song, which I think is misplaced on this record. She follows it up with Favorite, which is another god-awful Matrix song. I want to say that because it's the last Matrix song on the album, it gets far better than this, but it doesn't. Favorite is like all the other Matrix songs on the album, but saucier and more obviously about sex. She describes this person as being like her favorite underwear. In the first verse, she literally just describes what the underwear is like and how it's all old and faded before going into describing how she uses this guy and leaves him lying around on the bedroom floor like she does with her underwear. It's full of so many lyrical cliches that make the song a chore to sit through. The thing about all the Matrix songs on the album is that if they played in the background in a TV show or a shop or something, you wouldn't really think about it. It wouldn't hit you as anything particularly bad or good. But when you bite into it, you realize just how rotten and terrible it really is. Love Slash Hate is basically a really boring and average 80s rock song. It's like almost a hair metal song, but with the most cookie cutter instrumentation possible and a hook that is about as forgettable as a large portion of the album is. I honestly wish there was more to talk about in this song because it's followed by one of the worst songs I've ever heard and I really dread talking about it. Okay, before we get to this next song, I quickly want to look at Flower from Guyville. Flower is one of my favourite songs on Guyville. It's a song about female empowerment during sex. It's incredibly open, honest, and doesn't shy away from any of the details of her lust for this guy. It's graphic, but it works well because she's a young woman who isn't afraid to be bold and liberal-minded. This is something that travels throughout much of her first couple of albums in their more graphical sexual content. On this album, there is a graphic song about sex called Hot White Cum. It's a bouncy acoustic song about how Phair wants to sleep with a guy over and over again and use his cum to help with her skin. The problem with this song compared to things like Flower is that this song is uncomfortably graphic to the point where it feels like self-parody. She seems to be acting all edgy for the sake of it, and it isn't clever, forward-thinking, or bold like her other graphic sex songs. The lyrics here are just ridiculous, incredibly silly, and so repetitive to the point it gets annoying almost instantly. The chorus has a weird flow to it as well, which just doesn't work in the slightest, and the line, "Gimme your hot white cum," is just gross to listen to. There's a review that Pop Matters did of this album in which they compare this song to Tenacious D, and that is pretty much spot on. This song sounds like a comedy song, but is sung with such sincerity that the final result is an awkwardly hilarious mess of a song which is painful to listen to. The next song, My Bionic Eyes, is one of the weirdest songs on the album because I actually really like most of it, but there are a few lyrics I don't think work that well. It's one of the few songs on the album that I think is classic Liz Phair to the point where it could have been an outtake from her previous album. It has a clean yet abrasive tone to it, a really catchy hook, and some really cool sounding instrumentation and production. The verses are the biggest problem with the song because the lyrics switch between being really interesting and poetic to being pretty damn terrible. I also don't think the vocal melodies in the verses work that well, and that distorted sound in it makes it sound like a million other pop rock songs, but it's a song that's far from bad. The last two songs on the album, Friend of Mine and Good Love Never Dies, are basically the exact same songs. They have really cheesy Sheryl Crow sounding country pop rock sounds to them, which although isn't particularly bad, it's also very boring and forgettable. Like, I couldn't tell you how they go at all, and I have listened to them multiple times while writing this review. It's like ending a torture session with a cold shower. It doesn't feel as bad as the torture, but it doesn't really make you feel any better and just makes you wish it was all over. Liz Phair's 2003 self-titled album was seen with some of the worst reviews of her entire career, and some of the worst reviews of any album of its year. It's the 16th lowest rated album on Metacritic, placing it even lower than Soulja Boy's I Soulja Boy, Tell 'Em, and the Chainsmokers' god-awful debut. She was accused of being a huge sellout, and many considered the album to be career suicide despite the commercial success. However, she's been fairly busy in the 16 years since its release. She released two more albums, both of which are pretty bland and forgettable. She's toured a lot, including doing a support slot for the Smashing Pumpkins a few years back. She released a huge retrospective box set for Guyville last year, containing all her old demo CDs released under the name of Girly Sound. And this year, she's carrying on her Girly Sound tour and also releasing a book. Looking at the set list from her current tour, it looks like she puts on a pretty good show, with a set comprising mostly of Guyville and Girly Sound songs, with a handful from her second and third albums, as well as the two singles from this album. So clearly, despite the massive backlash towards the album, she's carrying on and not stopping, which is great to see. She's currently working on new material, and considering it's been almost a decade since her last album, maybe the time off and looking back on her older stuff will serve her new music well, and we'll get an album that harkens back to the glory days of her career. I guess time will tell. Thanks for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed this new style of video, and I'll see you soon.